It might surprise you to learn that the basic chemistry of lithium-ion batteries at the heart of every brand new Tesla or iPhone hasn't changed all that much in the last 30 years. So when several of you left comments pointing me in the direction of a new company that's replacing a key part of that battery with silicon and some nanowires, my curiosity was piqued. And to add to that, one of my science advisory team members brought them up too, which only added fuel to the curiosity fire. Now, we've covered a lot of batteries on the channel, so what makes the company Amprius and other similar companies going after silicon stand out for the future of battery tech? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. Silicon batteries really piqued my curiosity to try and learn more. So to get right into it, why is Amprius' approach with simple silicon and some nanowires standing out in the world of batteries? Well, Amprius, which is a Stanford University startup based out of Fremont, California, is building on the tried and true lithium-ion battery idea by replacing one small but important component with a very common material. And it's resulting in massive improvements. But what component is that? Well, the graphite or carbon anode of a lithium-ion battery is critical, practically the heart of the battery. And while it allows the whole thing to function, it's not very efficient. In a lithium-ion battery, an electrolyte carries positively charged lithium ions from the carbon or graphite anode to the cathode. And important to note, both the anode and the cathode store lithium. It takes 6 graphite atoms to store just one lithium ion during charging, through a process called intercalation. Now, this is a pretty major bottleneck that limits the final energy density that a lithium cell can achieve. For smaller applications, such as wearable tech or your phone, this might not be an issue. But when it comes to something like an electric vehicle, limited lithium storage starts to dredge up boogeymen like range anxiety and long charge times. And these problems are often exaggerated by EV critics, but they still are real problems. When we try to go for even bigger applications like rechargeable semi-trucks or commercial planes, these setbacks only become more pronounced. Plus, the increased size and weight of these larger vehicles generally makes the battery's job much harder, if not impossible. Now, Amprius and others have identified the graphite or carbon anode as this squeaky but easily fixable wheel here, and they've settled on silicon as the perfect fix. Now, silicon is much, much better at storing lithium than graphite, with a single silicon atom capable of storing 4 lithium ions. That alone means that the silicon anodes are up to 24 times more efficient than a typical graphite anode. It also allows silicon anode batteries to be nearly 10 times more energy dense than lithium-ion batteries with conventional graphite anodes. And more density equals less battery. In other words, less battery weight to achieve the same exact performance. But that, of course, raises the question, why isn't everybody using silicon? I know I was asking that question. Well, first off, silicon may be a little too good at storing lithium. It has a tendency to grab so much lithium that it can increase in volume 3 to 4 times during charging. After just a few charge-discharge cycles, this swelling can cause the anode to crack and eventually destroy the battery. As a result, we usually only see a little bit of silicon mixed into our standard carbon anodes, just enough to up the efficiency without creating those swelling issues. We're seeing this across the industry right now. Tesla spoke at length back in 2020 at their Battery Day event on how they're working to integrate small amounts of silicon into their newest batteries. Now, we're talking a lot about Amprius, but I was really curious who else was out there going down a similar path with silicon. That's what got me curious about this topic in the first place. If this is really a good path for batteries, then you'd expect to see a lot of people and organizations investigating the same thing. Well, Amprius is definitely not alone. Coming out of California, there's also 1D from Palo Alto and Sila Nanotechnologies in Alameda. Sila's actually building a factory in Moses Lake, Washington, which puts them not too far from Group 14 Technologies over in Woodinville, who are also using silicon anode technology. These groups all have slightly different spins on the silicon anode, and they're already seeing commercial successes, and we'll talk about them more in a bit, but suffice to say, there's a growing consensus around silicon. So how are Amprius and the others getting around the swelling issue? Well, before we get into that, there's something else that you should get around, and that's online tracking and targeting. And today's sponsor, Surfshark, can help you with that. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising. A VPN can protect you from some of that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. I used this exact feature on a trip I just took to Vancouver. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code UNDECIDED to get up to 6 additional months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. The link's in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to the question, how are Amprius and others getting around the swelling issue? Nanotech. Amprius grows silicon nanowires directly from the current collector, then coats them in silicon to form an anode that almost looks like a forest full of trees. The result is a geometric structure that's nearly 100% silicon. This makes it much easier for ions and electrons to move as they travel in a shorter distance, which improves charge and discharge times. The nanostructure also provides more surface area than graphite, which further improves the energy density. And of course, it helps to deal with the hungry silicon issue too.
Hungry hippo.
By using a nanowire form factor, there's enough space in between those wires to accommodate volume expansion, making the anode much more durable. Not to mention, the thinner profile makes it flexible enough to bend with the substrate. It's a really clever design. Normally, these nanotech solutions are difficult to scale. After all, we're talking about silicon nanowires, the size of a few microns, which are several times smaller than the width of a hair. Plus, if you want to reap all the amazing benefits, you have to find a way to make these small structures at a large capacity. Amprius hopes to solve this issue by partnering with the Dutch company Centrotherm. They have decades of experience scaling materials for the semiconductor and solar industries, and their pilot scale process is trying to achieve lower production costs and higher throughput with a roll-to-roll manufacturing process. So Amprius's battery is energy dense, reliable, and potentially cheaper, but how do the numbers actually work out? It looks really good on paper. Amprius's battery has an energy density of 450 watt-hours per kilogram, or 1,150 watt-hours per liter. That's 50% better than some of the best lithium-ion batteries on the market. Amprius also claims their power density is high, up to 10C versus lithium's usual 3C. And the C rating is a measure of how quickly a battery can safely charge and discharge. The higher the C rating, the faster the charging and discharging rates. And this not only affects the time spent on charging the battery, but how quickly the power can be released for intense applications. For example, a regular flashlight can operate with a low C rating, as it only operates on low discharge rates over a long period of time. A performance or racing drone, which needs quick bursts of energy, needs batteries with a much higher C rating. And best of all, for the average consumer, Amprius's battery can hit an 80% charge in a little under 6 minutes. And one of the most common and realistic complaints about EVs is that it takes much more time to charge a battery than to fill a gas tank. Now, if the Amprius battery can charge in just 6 minutes, that delta between refueling a gas car and recharging an EV is getting really small. Engineering aside, silicon has some economic benefits too, at least potentially. Unlike some of the other proposed battery materials that are out there, silicon isn't an expensive or difficult to produce next-gen alloy. It's actually the second most common element on Earth. This should help bring down the battery costs and ensure that there aren't supply chain issues. For comparison, 90% of the world's graphite comes from just one region in China, which could present a huge supply chain vulnerability. Silicon may have an environmental edge too, as recent studies have shown that graphite mining and smelting aren't the best for the environment. Smelting graphite is a very energy-intensive process that still relies on some of the dirtiest fossil fuels. The studies suggest that emissions from these processes are 4 to 10 times worse than we previously thought. So yeah, maybe we should bring on the silicon anodes quick. But ultimately, why does this even matter? What can we do with a radically more energy-dense battery? Well, as we've hinted at a few times, this could be a great leap forward for EVs. In terms of vehicle performance, an Amprius EV could charge in minutes and have potentially faster 0 to 60 performance times. It might even open the door for larger EVs like semi-trucks and commercial flight, but that's speculative for now. And while it's not as exciting as high-performance EVs or some other possible applications, the silicon anode battery could be very convenient for wearables and consumer electronics. Just imagine a phone or a laptop that charges to full in minutes and a charge that lasts far longer. Now, even with all these possibilities, Amprius's current focus is on unmanned aerial vehicles. Most consumer drones have a 20 to 30 minute battery life, and Amprius claims it can double that. Now, this is great not just for the drone hobbyists, but it could really make a difference for search and rescue or research applications. Then there's Airbus's Zephyr S, a high altitude pseudo-satellite, or HAPS. It's sort of a drone-satellite hybrid. With Amprius's batteries on board, the Zephyr S flew for more than 25 days, setting a new endurance and altitude record for stratospheric flight. Amprius is also touting some successful uses of their battery tech in electric vertical takeoff and landing, or eVTOL, aircraft. Now, I have my doubts that eVTOL air taxis will ever really be viable, but it's a cool demo of Amprius's tech and could have implications for electrifying commercial flight way down the road. But that begs the question, if Amprius can currently electrify some cutting-edge aircraft, then why isn't your laptop or car currently powered by a silicon anode battery? Well, the nanotech that allows Amprius's batteries to bypass the normal silicon swelling issue could ironically be its greatest weakness. Now, silicon anodes are currently more expensive to produce than lithium anodes because they require specialized equipment and techniques. As it turns out, the creation of nanowires is much more complicated than making standard electrical wire. Standard electrical wire is drawn through dyes to achieve smaller gauges. Nanowires must be grown directionally from vapor, sol gel, or electrochemical processes, not drawn like regular wire. So while silicon may be plentiful, the manufacturing process is the limiting factor that could make these batteries too expensive to see in use outside of the most extreme situations for now. And while Amprius's batteries have performed well in a lab and field tests so far, nanotech can be difficult to scale up from lab to meaningful real-world applications. As we noted earlier, Amprius is actively trying to address this with Centrotherm's help and their pilot line roll-to-roll process. But can they do it affordably over time? That's what remains to be seen. And on top of that, Amprius's tech requires proprietary anodes that are currently not compatible with existing large EV cell factories. This is partially why Amprius's current strategy is to focus on niche markets like unmanned aerial vehicles. If that's successful enough, then they can ramp up production, bring down the costs, and start to expand into the consumer EV market. Even if everything works perfectly, it will be a while before you can purchase a long-range, fast-charging EV with an Amprius battery inside. Still, Amprius's battery sounds very promising. Maybe too promising. Is this a too-good-to-be-true situation? For the concept of the battery, probably not. Their tech has been vetted by Mobile Power Solutions, a leading battery testing house, but it's going to take a few more verifications from national labs or universities before I can fully move it out of the wait-and-see category. Even with further testing required, things are looking good for Amprius so far. The company is gearing up for mass production by building a 103-acre campus, including an existing 1.2 million square foot facility in Brighton, Colorado. This factory is expected to greatly increase Amprius's manufacturing capacity with an initial 500 megawatt hours and the potential of up to 5 gigawatt hours available within the existing footprint. Now, their goal is to be up and running within a couple of years. As I mentioned earlier, Amprius isn't the only company seeing success with silicon and nanotech. 1D has partnered with GM and are also looking at nanotech solutions for silicon anode batteries. Together, they're creating the GM Ultium silicon anode battery cells. Sila Nanotechnologies have had their batteries inside a Whoop's fitness tracker wearable since 2021. Their more powerful battery will come standard in the Mercedes G-Class SUV starting in 2026. Also, Group 14 Technologies should have its silicon battery powering Porsches sometime next year. All these companies are in the process of preparing for mass production, which is always a good sign. So will silicon anode batteries change the world? It looks like we won't have to wait very long to find out. Do you think silicon batteries are where the industry is heading? Jump in the comments and let me know. Be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every single video. Your support really helps us to keep delivering these videos every single week. If you'd like to support the channel and get in early on the videos, check out the link in the description below. And I'll see you in the next one.